It kind of seems that a lot of feminists, not all feminists, and not official feminism, you know, not according to the feminist literature, but it seems that a lot of feminists would prefer if most men were gay, primarily because gay men objectify women differently than straight men. Gay men objectify women for their hair and their makeup and their outfits and the time and money they spend to make their appearance look the way they do. It's okay to objectify women that way. But if you objectify their bodies, that's bad. There's more to this, obviously. Feminism doesn't accept the idea that someone's upbringing has a great deal to do with their sexuality. I don't think they'd accept the idea that someone having really bad relations, a boy having very bad relations with their father, or they don't have a father at all, and they have a somewhat overbearing mother, or a mother who, I mean, has to do what they can because they're the only one raising the kid, you know, that has nothing to do with how the boy's sexuality turns out when they're finally going through puberty. Nope, that has nothing to do with it. It's all genetic or epigenetics. It's those things, and that's the only way it could possibly be. But I mean, reason why I'm saying this is because a lot of the feminist thought is this idea that boys don't need male role models. They don't need a male father figure. That's not important at all. They can still get those roles through women, because women are the same as men. Just the genitalia is different. I mean, you got these people that get offended. You know, there's someone gets up to do a college speech, and they just simply say, "Well, men on average are taller than women," and then you have people walking out of the seminar because, oh, that's offensive. Yeah, you can't even accept the idea that men on average are taller than women.
James argues, accurately, that there are differences between men and women. This is a strange position to be in, to be arguing for something that is so universally and widely accepted within biology. What is not as widely accepted is that culture is also evolutionary, but I'm going to argue that biology and culture are both evolutionary. Let's look at differences between men and women that are explicitly anatomical and physiological. Are men taller than women on average? Does anyone take offense at that fact? Are you irritated?
There's always a standout.
So I would say, you could be irritated by it. You could be irritated by the fact that women have to be the ones to gestate and lactate. You could be irritated by a lot of truths. But taking offense is a response that is rejection of reality.
So, you know, if they can't accept that, then they're obviously not going to be able to accept the idea that having an actual male role model is important to boys. They obviously don't seem to care about the suicide rate of boys, of men. They'll just blame it on, the standards for masculinity are toxic. They'll blame it on that, and not on boys not having decent role models. Of course, the way that they'll push things is, well, the male role models should be men who act like women or gay men. That should be the role models for boys. You know, so again, where the only objectification of women is, oh, how great their hair is and their makeup and their outfits and how much money and time they spend. It's depressing. Like I said, it just kind of seems like they want men to be gay. They want most men to be gay. Men to be able to turn on and off at will their actual sexual attractions to the female body. Just turn it on and off. Just be able to flip a switch and it's on, and flip a switch and it's off. Flip a switch when it's on, when the woman wants it to be that way. Otherwise, it should be off. This is not to say that just having one parent, a female parent, or having two female parents can't be as effective and can't show boys what it is to be male if they really, really work hard at it. But I think they really, really have to work hard at it to achieve that. When we look at how the black community, what kind of parenting that most of the kids who end up turning to gangs, what goes on in those families? Well, it's usually an absent father. Now, you could say, oh, well, those fathers need to step up. Okay, maybe. But most of the time, that isn't what's being pushed forth. What's being pushed forth is the boys need to not have toxic masculinity. Well, how is that going to happen unless they have fathers? How is that going to happen unless they have someone to show them decent standards to go by? When they're just learning about what it is to be a man from other kids their age, or just near their age, who also have a fucked up view of what it is to be a man, how are they supposed to turn out? I mentioned the black community because it seems to affect the black community more than a number of other communities. Now, that's not a gay thing, but the kind of actual toxic masculinity you find in the black community seems to be a lot more prevalent than in other communities. Now, you can be mad at me for saying that, but you just look and you see it. You look at the statistics, you see it. You listen to the music, and you see it. This is not to say that if you listen to other music that you don't find some fucked up messages too, but it's not nearly as prevalent. But it's really damaging for boys to not have fathers unless the mother or mothers really, really work hard to instill the values that they need to so the boys have a healthy sense of what it is to be masculine. Now, you could say that, oh, well, girls don't have to worry about that, so the problem is boys. You know, it's kind of like what they do in our education system. Boys have a different attention span than girls. So what do? Well, instead of adopting different ways of teaching for the boys, let's just pump the boys full of Ritalin and other drugs so they'll have the attention span that girls do. That makes me mad, too. That makes me very angry. I was one of those boys who got put on Ritalin because I had an attention span problem. If they would have just taught differently, it would be different. But no, it's the boys' fault. Our education system is geared around girls, around the way that girls learn. Guys are still expected to be the breadwinners in a family. There's a lot that's expected out of guys. And yet, the common narrative is that women have it so terrible. Now, I'm not saying that women don't have problems, that there aren't some systemic issues around women. I'm not denying those things. But when people go around continually denying that there are systemic problems that guys deal with, you know, fuck you. Women aren't expected to be the breadwinners, unless they're in a single mother household. Then they're expected of that. Then they're expected to do everything. Then we end up blaming the women for when the boys don't turn out that great. And most of the time, those mothers are trying the best they can. So don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to say that single mother households, the women are doing a poor job. They're doing the best they can. But again, kind of what I said near the beginning of the video, a lot of feminists out there seem to want men to have the standards that gay men have as far as what being masculine is. A lot of feminists out there would be very happy if most men were gay. And again, the kind of objectification that gets done by gay men towards women is, oh, my hair, my outfit, my makeup, the amount of time and effort I spend into looking the way that I want. They pay attention to me in the things that I spend so much effort in. Anyway.